There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, no, not one, no, not one. Now else could heal all our souls' diseases, no, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles, he will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, no, not one, no, not one. Hold a second. No friend like him is so high and low. No, not one, no, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. On the last, was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one, no, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one.
Amen. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Let's go to hymn number 12. Praise him, praise him. All three verses we'll sing. Hymn number 12, praise him, praise him. Yeah, that's it.
Our blessed Redeemer, sing, O earth, the wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory, grief and honor, give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. Excellent greatness, praise him, ever in joyful song.
Verse number 2,
praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer, for our sins he suffered and bled and died. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation.
Excellent greatness, praise him, ever in joyful song.
On the last,
praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer, heavenly portals, bound with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever.
Christ is coming over the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong.
Praise him, ever is excellent greatness. Praise him, ever is joyful song.
Amen. Remain standing.
Amen. Welcome back this evening at 5 o'clock. A little early for us, isn't it? But I'm glad you're here, and we're looking forward to having a good service and then having a fellowship afterwards. Appreciate you coming back. It's good to have you with us. Let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing. Father, we thank you for this time tonight to meet here in this place, and Lord, we do ask that you would be honored and glorified. Help us as we look again into your word, and Lord, we just pray that you would show us what we need to know and draw us closer to you as a result of what we'll read and study from your word this evening. Thank you for how you've spoke to hearts already today and through this Sunday evening series, Lord, on David and his life. And we're coming to an end, but Lord, there's been so much that has been so helpful for us over the past year and a half. And Lord, we just ask that tonight would be no different. Be with the fellowship and all that follows, and we'll give you the honor and glory and praise for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward if they would. Starting next Sunday, we are going to put the college age and single 20s class on hold until next summer. I think that's going to be the best way for us to proceed. The few that are left in that class who are in that age group can go to the class of their choice. There'll be some other adult classes they can choose to go to. Reason we're doing that is because we have Brother Williams. He is going to be teaching the junior boys, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade boys. And I'm thankful that he's willing to do that. He's been teaching that young adult class, but really, I don't know that there'd be a whole lot throughout the school year for that. If that class continues to grow with people that age group, we can talk about filling that class with another teacher. But I'm thankful that he's going to do that. And so starting next Sunday, if you have a elementary age boy, third, fourth, fifth, or sixth grade, they will meet with Sheriff Jim or Skeeter, depending on how he feels that particular morning. So we said we wanted fun and firm. So if Sheriff Jim will be the firm portion of it and Skeeter will be the fun, how about we just call him Sheriff Skeeter, and I think we'll have it all combined. But anyway, I'm glad that you're doing that, Brother Williams, because there is a good group of boys in that age group, and them being able to have a male teacher and presence and help there would be a blessing. All the elementary age girls and girls and boys who are, you know, kindergarten through second grade, they will still meet with Mrs. Freetag in her class. So that's not ending. Her class is continuing. We're just kicking the third through sixth grade boys out, and that'll be a good change and a good update that we're making there. So anyway, wanted to make sure I got that update out, and that's a good change for us. Be on the lookout for another email I'll send tomorrow with a few more things we need to have filled. Remember, keep praying about a new assistant pastor that the Lord would send our way that can work with youth and fill the roles that Brother Kushel had while he was here. We're just going to keep praying about that. Here's what I know. If we pray, God answers. And if we do pray and trust the Lord when the time comes, we don't have to worry about it. We don't have to wonder about it. We know that the Lord will have exactly the person there that needs to be in place. And there's a lot to be done. There's a lot of assistance that needs to be done. As a matter of fact, I think Mrs. Freetag said we were out of paper plates for tonight. So I think that's where Heather is. She's running to get plates right now. So stuff like that happens. And some of it is just we're getting used to not having as much assistance around. However, a lot of you have jumped up and have filled in and made sure that we have filled in the gaps. And so whether it was junior church today with Pop and Mimi, and then I know Brother Connor has filled in there. I know Chris McAvaney filled in. And then I know that we'll have a new Sunday school teacher here for the boys. And then there's just other things that we'll be asking. We have some additional help coming in King's Kids. I don't know where Jan is. Jan Matthews here tonight, and she's over there. I know that she's going to need a helper for the Flyers Club for Wednesday nights as well. So we'll get word out about these things, but can I say this? As a church, you all have filled in the gaps so far and are doing a great job. So thank you, but let's keep it up, and let's keep helping out, and we'll keep praying for God's will about exactly the man and wife that he wants to have here, and we'll trust him in that process. What else? Keep us in prayer. I think I've been mentioning it enough, but we'll take Trent to college this week. Pray for our college students as they go back, and we'll remember them as they are getting started with the fall semester. And then you'll see, if you have a bulletin, that we're going to have some focus on missionaries in the month of September, as well as our Faith Promise Sunday. And then in October, keep those dates in prayers. We'll plan on having our annual business meeting the first Sunday evening in October. And then we'll also plan on having a Friends Sunday and a fall picnic, weather permitting, that second Sunday, or if we need to take a rain check, the third Sunday. But as of right now, it'll be that second Sunday in October. We'll plan on doing all of that right here on site, and we'll trust the Lord for a great day that day. Let's pray for the offering. Brother John Ty, would you pray for the offering, please?
Thank you, Margaret, for that offertory. I recognize the second one, Balm and Gilead. The first one, though, what was the name of the first one?
God is my strong salvation.
Beautiful song. God is my strong salvation. Amen. Hymn number 653, Whiter Than Snow. If we stand, please. Whiter Than Snow, 653. We'll sing the first, second, and fourth on this. Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole. I want you forever to live in my soul. Break down every idol, cast out every foe. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. On the second. Lord Jesus, look down from your throne in the sky and help me to make a complete sacrifice. I give up myself and whatever I know. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Now wash me not shake hands with one another, and we'll sing that last one in a minute. As you make your way back to your seats, let's do that fourth stanza. Lord Jesus, before you I patiently wait. Come now and within me a new heart create. To those who have sought you, you never said no. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
All right, thank you. Would you turn in your Bibles with me tonight, please, to 2 Samuel chapter number 24. 2 Samuel chapter number 24. We are ending 2 Samuel this evening, and then we go into 1 Kings, and we're in 1 Kings for about another chapter or two, and then we come finally to the end of David's life. And I know it's been quite a journey, but it has been a good journey and an exciting one and a helpful one for all of us. I know it has certainly helped me. But we're in 2 Samuel chapter 24. We'll begin reading in verse 1. There the Bible says, "And again the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel. And he moved David against them to say, Go number Israel and Judah. For the king said to Joab, the captain of the host which was with him, Go now through all the tribes of Israel from Dan even to Beersheba, and number ye the people, that I may know the number of the people. And Joab said unto the king, Now the Lord thy God add unto the people, how many soever they be, 100-fold, and that the eyes of my Lord the King may see it. But why doth my Lord the King delight in this thing? Notwithstanding, the king's word prevailed against Joab and against the captains of the host. And Joab and the captains of the host went out from the presence of the king to number the people of Israel. And they passed over Jordan and pitched in Aroer on the right side of the city that lieth in the midst of the river of Gad and toward Jezreel. And then they came to Gilead, to the land of Tatim Hodshai. And they came to Dan Jaan and about to Zidon, and came to the stronghold of Tyre and to all the cities of the Hivites and of the Canaanites. And they went out to the south of Judah, even to Beersheba. So when they had gone through all the land, they came to Jerusalem at the end of 9 months and 20 days. And Joab gave up the sum of the number of the people unto the king. And there were in Israel 800,000 valiant men that drew the sword, and the men of Judah were 500,000 men. And David's heart smote him after that he had numbered the people. And David said unto the Lord, I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Lord, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly. I want to preach for a few moments on guarding against a prideful heart. Guarding against a prideful heart. One of the reasons I love reading about David is because we see him in all of his humanity. And sometimes we can make Bible characters almost like superheroes, and we can kind of imagine them to be more than human. But David was just a man. And David was human like you and I are, and he was prone to failing like you and I are as well. And throughout his life, we've seen some great mountaintop victories and some tremendous decisions. We've also seen some very low valleys, and many times he ends up in those valleys due to his own choosing, because of his own bad decisions. And this was one of them. And we find out the reason for this mistake was because of a proud heart. We have to guard against that, don't we? None of us is exempt. None of us is so humble that we could never be proud or prideful. And so we need help with this tonight. And I want to just pray and then for a few minutes consider a few thoughts from the passage. Let's pray together. Lord, I ask that you would help us for these few moments. Be with my voice, be with the preaching. I pray that it would be your word speaking to us. We need to hear from you. And Lord, I do pray that we would hear from you. And I ask that you would show us, Lord, where we might be prone to falling into pride and making a foolish decision. Maybe a decision that would be directly against what you would want for our life. And so I pray that you would just help us here this evening. Thank you for David's example, in both the good examples as well as even the not so good examples, so that we can learn from them. And I do pray that we would learn from them and help us to be better because of these things. We do thank you and love you. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen. David is an older man at this point in time in his life. He's really nearing the end. He's somewhere in his mid to late 60s, quickly approaching 70. And we know that David lived 70 years because at 30 years of age, he became king in Hebron and he reigned for 40 years. And so he's at the place where he's making his way towards the latter part of his life, closing in on 70. And he's at a point in time in his life where he's seen a lot done and a lot accomplished. And here, even later in life, after having lived many years, after having experienced many things, after having won great victories but also suffered defeats, after having been blessed of God but also having to learn hard lessons of his own choosing, we see even later in life he makes a mistake. And before we look too far down on David, we have to understand we're all prone to this. And it doesn't matter if we're 7 years old or 70 years old. We're all prone to making mistakes because we're sinful creatures. We fall far short, and we need God's help every day, and we need to rely upon the Lord. What does David do in this passage? Well, the Bible says that he decides that he's going to number Israel and Judah. He wants to number all the men and all the people. And taking a census within and of itself wasn't the problem. My study Bible even tells me that God had previously ordered Moses to make two censuses back in Numbers chapters 1 and 26. But in this case, we see that Satan seized upon the growing pride of David's heart to incite him into taking a census when the Lord had not given the command to do so. And the reason for taking that census was so that David could have a ground for boasting. So that, not so that he could truly know the numbers of the people, but so that he could say, look at what I have done. We have to be careful about that. We have to be careful about not looking at what God has perhaps done or achieved in our lives and having a big head about that, or maybe saying, look at what I've accomplished, because every good and perfect gift cometh from above. Even in this matter of numbers, if you know anything about independent Baptists, man, they focused on numbers like you wouldn't believe back in the 1950s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. During those decades, it was all about the numbers. How many did you have in Sunday school, and how many did you have in church, and how many did you have saved, and how many came to know the Lord out on soul winning on Tuesday night, and how many have you had baptized through the baptistry, and on and on and on and on it went. Now, are numbers a problem? They don't have to be. I think numbers are good because they can help us to track things. We always count how many people we have here every Sunday. We take attendance for Sunday school, for Sunday morning, for Sunday night. So we do that. And there's nothing wrong with taking numbers so that we can get an idea of things. I think that's wise. I think that's a good practice. We always count the offering here. We better know how much money we're taking in. We shouldn't just leave that to guessing. We need to know how much we're taking in, and we need to track that and have good records of that. That's all important. But I can tell you that the very thing we see here is the same exact way in which people have gotten caught up in pride in decades gone by. If it's all about we had this many people in church so that we can brag about how many people we had in church, that's the wrong reason for doing it. If we had a lot of people in church, thank God that he gave people to you to be in church. Thank the Lord you can come to a church where there's people that are here. Thank the Lord that you can come to a church where there's other like-minded believers. Not every church has that. And so we should be thankful to God. If someone got saved, then praise the Lord for that. I to this day don't know how many people I've led to the Lord. I don't want to keep a track of that, but here's what I do know. God knows those things. I'll leave it to him. I think we should be aggressive with the gospel. I think we should be desirous to reach as many as we can. But I have found, and I've learned a long time ago, leave the results in God's hands. I think, I can't remember how far in, I think maybe 6 or 7 years into having started the church, one particular year in our annual business meeting, I got real aggressive, and I can remember saying, I want to see this many people in church by this time, and maybe some of you remember it, and I can't remember all that I said, but I was getting a little frustrated and wanted to see more, and so I started setting out some numbers out there of what how many people I wanted to see in church and how many people I wanted to see us all bring and all this, and things never went worse after that. Sometimes we can get a little out of sorts with that. And it's not just with numbers. That's just one outworking of it. But pride manifests itself in many different ways. In this particular instance in David's life, it had to do with numbering the people. My first thought tonight is this: it can be awfully easy to become proud. It's not hard for us to become prideful. And it can be about a number of different things. Maybe it's not about numbers, but maybe for you, it's about ability. Or maybe God has gifted you in a certain way. Maybe you have the ability to teach, or you have the ability to speak, or the ability to maybe do any number of things analytically. Maybe behind the scenes you can process and organize information. Maybe God has really gifted you in some areas. Praise the Lord for that, but let's let God be glorified in it. Because no matter what we have that we've been blessed with, no matter what we're good at, as I mentioned, God is to receive the glory. David forgot that. David later in life probably thought to himself, you know, I've had my lumps. Not everything has been perfect, but I've done pretty good. And as I look out from my palace across the kingdom that has been tried to be taken from me and so on and so forth, and I see all these people and all these soldiers, I'd like to know how many people are here. I'd like to know how good it's been. I'd like to know how good I've been. It quickly became about him rather than the Lord. And I would just implore all of us tonight, let's keep a humble heart. Let's keep a humble heart. Everything that we do here is about the Lord. And I know that God has to gift people in the local church, but he doesn't have to use any of us. He does use you with the abilities he's given you, but he can just as easily use somebody else. And unless we think it's all about us, we have to quickly grow humble and say to ourselves, you know what? It's not really about me. It's about what God can and wants to do through me, and I'll just give him the praise and the honor for it. David had to learn this lesson even at the end of his life yet again. He begins to put this plan in place to number the people, and even Joab, who we've learned so much about, tries to warn him against this. Verse 3, and Joab said unto the king, now the Lord thy God add unto the people. Joab's a conflicting character. I agree with him in this. Let God add. Let God take care of the numbers. How many soever they be, 100-fold, and that the eyes of my Lord the king may see it. But why doth my Lord the king delight in this thing? David doesn't give a direct answer, but notice verse 4. Notwithstanding, the king's word prevailed against Joab, against the captains of the host, and Joab and the captains of the host went out from the presence of the king to number the people of Israel. Joab, who had killed David's own son. Joab, who had several times double-crossed and backstabbed the king. Joab, who had his own issues and his own problems and probably deserved to be put to death long ago. The Lord actually uses to speak some sense to the king. Again, God can use anyone. And he uses Joab here to tell David, David, why do you delight in this? Why is this something that you want to do? The Bible doesn't say exactly how David answers, but it does say that his word prevailed over Joab. So David basically said, I'm the king. I told you what to do. Go number the people. Okay. As you wish. Yes, sir. We'll go and we'll number all the people. And number all the people they did. Secondly, here's the next thought. We need to refuse to think higher of ourselves than we really are. The Bible says, wherefore let he that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 18 reminds us of this. Pride goeth before what? Destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. And so before destruction, usually there's pride that precedes that. A haughty spirit goes before a fall. And when the Lord humbles us, it helps us to realize, whoa, I'm not near as in control as I thought I was. And sometimes we need a good dose of humble pie. Sometimes we do need a dose of reality to set in and to help us to realize we're not as big britches as we thought. We're not as big stuff as we thought we were. And the Lord will do that. The Lord will do that. The Lord's humbled me more than a few times in my life. And when God humbles me, it's been some of the most helpful times I've gone through. But if I don't learn the lesson and I refuse to be humble, things get a whole lot worse. But when the Lord crushes my heart and crushes my spirit and shows to me that I'm completely relying upon Him, it's been some of the most helpful times of spiritual growth that I've ever gone through. But the Lord has to sometimes really humble us, doesn't He? Well, David needed that. David went on and he humbled, or without humility, he numbered the people. And there's quite a lot of people that were numbered. In verse 9, the Bible says, in Israel there were 800,000 valiant men that drew the sword. And of the men of Judah were 500,000 men. Imagine having at your disposal 1,300,000 fighting valiant men. That's quite an army, especially in the day and time in which they lived. And once the numbers came back, here's how the Lord often works. Once the numbers came back and they were reported, that's when the Lord got a hold of David's heart. Right after we involve ourselves in that bit of pride, stroking our own ego, that's when the Lord does some of His greatest work in our heart. Notice what the Bible says in verse 10. And David's heart smote him after that he had numbered the people. And David said unto the Lord, I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Lord, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly. Sooner or later, the Lord's going to reveal to us where we've gone wrong. David had it revealed to him. He should have never made the decision to number the people as he did. Verse 11, for when David was up in the morning, the word of the Lord came unto the prophet Gad, David's seer, saying, go and say unto David, thus saith the Lord, I offer thee three things. Choose thee one of them, that I may do it unto thee. So Gad came to David and told him, and said unto him, shall 7 years of famine come unto thee in thy land? Or wilt thou flee 3 months before thine enemies while they pursue thee? Or that there be 3 days pestilence in thy land? Now advise and see what answer I shall return to him that sent me. And David said unto Gad, I am in a great strait. Let us fall now into the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great, and let me not fall into the hand of man. So Gad comes to David and he has some choices to make. Are you going to go through 7 years of famine in the land? Or are you going to flee for 3 months from your enemies? Or are you going to choose 3 days pestilence in the land? Advise and see what answer I shall return to him that sent me. And here's what David says. David says, I need to fall into the hands of God. And he says, if I put myself in the hands of my enemies, that could go very bad. And 7 years of famine is a long time. But with this matter of 3 days pestilence, that's at least in God's hands. And I'm going to put myself in the hands of God, and I'm going to make my decision according to that. That's a wise thing. So just as David made a foolish decision, we also see him in his punishment making a very wise decision. Verse 15, so the Lord sent the pestilence upon Israel from the morning even to the time appointed, and there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men. That brings me to my third thought, and that's this. There's a penalty for indulging in pride. The penalty here was steep. The lives of 70,000 men. That's a big chunk of men. The punishment was very appropriate. And it was actually David reaping exactly what he sowed. He got all caught up in numbering the men that he had. And the Lord, like that, takes away 70,000 of them. We always reap what we sow, and we always reap according to how we sow in the same way. The Lord has a way of dealing with us in such ways. And there's always a penalty for indulging in pride. Now, this is difficult to read, but I'll tell you, I think it can be a great deterrent from us going down the road of pride in our own life. And it might just save us from seeing some real difficulty down the road. Because we can learn from this example and say, no, I'm not even going to go there. I'm not even going to promote myself in such a way. I'm not even going to dare think about becoming puffed up in my own mind and becoming full of myself and thinking of myself more than the Lord, or thinking that I'm more important than God or anyone else. No, I'm going to be humble where I am. Wherefore, he that thinketh he standeth, take heed lest he fall. Because pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Now notice what happens. Verse 16, and when the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord repented him of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed the people, it is enough. Stay now thine hand. And the angel of the Lord was by the threshing place of Araunah the Jebusite. And David spake unto the Lord when he saw the angel that smote the people and said, lo, I have sinned and I have done wickedly, but these sheep, what have they done? Let thine hand, I pray thee, be against me and against my father's house. And Gad came that day to David and said unto him, go up, rear an altar unto the Lord in the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. And David, according to the saying of Gad, went up as the Lord commanded. And Araunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and bowed himself before the king on his face upon the ground. And Araunah said, wherefore is my lord the king come to his servant? And David said, to buy the threshing floor of thee, to build an altar unto the Lord, that the plague may be stayed from the people. And Araunah said unto David, let my lord the king take and offer up what seemeth good unto him. Behold, here be oxen for burnt sacrifice, and threshing instruments, and other instruments of the oxen for wood. All these things did Araunah as a king give unto the king. And Araunah said unto the king, the Lord thy God accept thee. And the king said unto Araunah, nay, but I will surely buy it of thee at a price. Neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which doth cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. And David built there an altar unto the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord was entreated for the land, and the plague was stayed from Israel. My fourth and final thought is this: our offerings to the Lord should cost us something. As David is fulfilling his punishment, he's told by Gad to go and offer a sacrifice at the threshing floor of Araunah. As he gets there, Araunah notices this is King David, and he's about to give him everything he needs. The threshing floor, the oxen for sacrifice, the instruments, everything to put the sacrifice upon the altar. David, as a king to a king, I'm going to give this to you. How could I not just allow you to have these things? Take them and offer freely the sacrifice unto the Lord. And David says, no way. I've learned my lesson. And I'm not there going to offer a sacrifice unto the Lord that costs me nothing. It had better cost me something. And I found this to be true. Serving the Lord and living for God should have a cost involved with it. For us to just think that service to God is going to be something that doesn't cost us much and doesn't involve much, if we think that to ourselves, we're deceiving ourselves. There's a cost to living for God. There's a cost to serving God. There's a cost to making it a priority to be in church, isn't there? Glad you're here tonight. There's a cost involved to being present, and there's a cost involved to teaching a class. There's a cost involved to living the Christian life and getting on our knees in prayer and getting into the Word of God. There's a cost involved to serving around the local church, but it's a great cost. There's a cost involved getting up early and coming to men's prayer meeting. But I can tell you this, when you come out, men, you'll leave better than you came. You're not beyond men's prayer meeting. I don't care how long you've been at this church. You're not beyond men's prayer meeting. You're not bigger than that. Guess what? Neither am I. That's why I go. not just because I'm the pastor. You're not beyond Sunday school. You're not beyond going out and doing some work around the church. I walked out here and Saturday, I saw Sonny cutting the grass. I was thankful for that. And it was high. It was big. It was like a jungle out there. But we're not beyond that. We're not beyond cleaning up around here. I've said it before. Our facility is not so large that the people of this church can't do the work to keep it clean. And maybe there'll be a day where we'll pay someone, but I'd really rather not. I think it keeps us grounded and humbled for the people of God to do the work of God around here. Are you too big to clean bathrooms? Yesterday after men's prayer meeting, I said, all right, we need to get these bathrooms taken care of. I said, Trent and Johnny, it's time to stop eating donuts and talking, and it's time for us to scrub some toilets. It's time for us to run some vacuums. You're not too big for the nursery. I put it out recently that we want to see some of our moms in the nursery. And you ought to work in there. And I'm thankful for those who do. But none of us should have a spirit that says, don't talk to me about the nursery. No, listen, here's the reality of the situation. None of us are beyond anything for the work of the God and the work of the Lord. And we should have a heart that says, I'll do whatever God wants me to do. And I'll do it happily. And I'm going to do what God wants me to do, and I'm going to serve God. And yes, I know there's a cost involved, but it's a good cost. How else should we be spending our lives? Sleeping on Saturday or going to the dump or doing what we'd rather do? Making our house look perfect and our yard look great but not ever touching a blade of grass out there? Look, I'm just being honest, folks. There's a cost involved to serving the Lord. And some of us have a mindset that says, sure, I'll be there, I'll do it. Whatever is needed, I'll happily jump in. But others of us say, I've been around here a long time. I don't need to do that. Someone else can do it. Oh, no, my friend, you need to do it. God wants your involvement. There's a cost to serving God, but it's a good cost. And you know what David said? David said, what's necessary to do, I'm going to do. And I'm going to happily do it. I'm not going to dare offer an offering or a sacrifice unto God of that which costs me nothing. Now, we have a good church and we have good folks, but don't dare think that you somehow have arrived, because none of us have. And I'm preaching to myself while I'm up here preaching. There's a lot more I can do for the Lord. There's a lot more I can do for serving God. And God wants the involvement of every one of us. How are we doing? How's your ego? Does this message hurt it? If it does, maybe we need to come before the Lord and leave it at the altar. Because I think God's people sometimes grow entirely too proud and think far more highly of ourselves than we ever ought to think. And it'd be great for us to be humbled a bit. I got sick again. You can hear it in my voice again. But you remember what happened during COVID. I was COVID-free. It never touched me. I felt like I was the Teflon Don. You know, I walked around. I'm fine. This is nothing. And then I became an expert. And I started telling people about how they needed to take their vitamin B12 and how they needed to, you know, take more of this and more of that and get the zinc in your system. And you guys, you know, if you just did what I did, you'd be great, you know. And then this past spring, and yet again, I've had another round of it. It's been bad for me physically. And I got sick. And once I finally got over 3 months of coughing and a voice that was just about gone, you remember what it was like. February, you know, March, April, May. It was pretty much February, March, April. It was 4 months of my voice really not being normal. And I finally got over that in June and July. But it's almost like the Lord says, I got your vocal cords right here. And if you think you're done and you think you're better than you are, guess what? I'll tweak them. And here I am again. And I think it's healthy for me to be reminded that God's in control. He's in control of my health. He's in control of your health. He's in control of your existence. He's in control of your home, of your family. He's in control of your day in and day out activities. God's in control. And before we get to the place where we're greatly humbled like David was, let's humble ourselves before the Lord. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. And what does the Bible say? He will lift you up. Let's do that. Let's humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord and he'll lift us up. If there's a cost involved to being involved with the Lord and living for God, then so be it. Let's spend ourselves giving of ourselves to the cost involved for the cause of Christ. We'll never ever be sorry that we did. I've never heard a story of someone coming to the end of their life having served the Lord Jesus Christ with their life saying, man, I blew it. I just wasted my life. I live for Jesus. What a terrible existence I've had. That's never been said. But there's been many, many, many people who've come to the end of their life and say, I live for myself. What a waste. I live for the next dollar bill, and it's fulfilled nothing. I am so sad that I spent my life living in this way. Let's learn from this tonight. Let's be humble. Let's ask God for his help and for his direction in our life to truly make us humble people of God. And let's watch what he does as he lifts us up. Listen, if you need to be lifted up, God knows that and he'll lift you up. But let's let him do the lifting. Let's trust him tonight. Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you tonight for this passage. I pray that we would be a humble people. I pray that we would never think more highly of ourselves than we ought to think, even in the way that we approach interactions and involvements with other people, with believers. Help us to give time to everybody. Lord, at a time of fellowship tonight, help us to spend some time with God's people. Help us to humbly be kind to everyone. Lord, help us not to grow a big ego and make the mistake of believing that we're more than we really are. Lord, in the life and ministry of Truth Baptist, I pray that we would just be a humble group of people moving forward, trusting you, Lord, to do with us what only you can, and knowing that all of this is because of you, that you've been incredibly good, and that you have blessed. And Lord, we don't want to get ahead of you, and we don't want to make the mistake of believing that somehow we're responsible. And I pray that we could humble ourselves before you humble us. And Lord, I don't know what the future holds, and I'm not trying to predict anything, and I don't even know how this might be applied to people specifically who are listening to the message tonight. But I know this, we can all become proud pretty easily. And we need to die to the flesh and die to self and be filled with the Spirit. And I pray that we would humbly do so this evening. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for saving us. Thank you, Lord, for humbling yourself and taking upon yourself the form of a servant and becoming obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, so that we could be saved. May we never get over that. Lord, take a moment or two in this invitation, and may we just speak to you and allow you to have your way with us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I'm going to ask that we all stand to our feet quietly tonight with heads bowed and with eyes closed as the piano begins to play. I want to ask that we would just respond as the Lord has prompted. Have your own way, Lord. Not my way, but your way. Have your way with me. Show me what I need to know. Show me what I need to learn. again, thank you for being here this evening. We're going to go downstairs and have a time of fellowship. And I believe Trent's our college student that we have here. Spencer had to leave and go up to Patrick Henry College there in Purcellville a couple weeks early for soccer. And so we're thinking of him. And I think Jeremy Wells is going off to college as well, and maybe a few others. But Trent's here tonight, and it'll be his last service at Truth for a little while. I've shared this with you, and I'm not going to get all sentimental, but his very first memory in life is riding the Penske truck from Ohio to Virginia. And he rode up front, and he said, I'd never forget that trip because I'd never got to ride up front like that before. And maybe as a not even yet two-year-old, he shouldn't have been riding up front in the Penske truck. But he was strapped in. He was in his seat and everything. And we went down the Pennsylvania Turnpike. We drove the full 8-9 hours, whatever it was. He didn't say a peep the whole time. And I can remember, he just was wide-eyed, and he just loved being there. He says that's his first memory in life. He was a couple months away from being 2 years old. We moved here in March. We started the church on April 16th. 2 days later, on April 18th, he turned 2 years of age. He's always been my soul-winning partner. He's been my right-hand man and the right-hand man of our family and everything that we've done, whether it was knocking on doors, whether it was stacking and unstacking chairs many, many times. You just name it, the work of the ministry. He was my son. He didn't get to say no. He was going to be involved whether he wanted to be or not. And you know what? He's done a great job. He's been a great right-hand man. And for many, many years, here now for 16-plus years, he's been a blessing. So I wanted to say that tonight. I know I've said that before, but it's very meaningful for me as he goes to college to just say, buddy, you've done a good job. You've helped your mom and dad. You've helped our church. And now we want to give him a proper farewell this evening, okay? And so spend some time talking to him. He's really been a help and a blessing. I said to my Sunday school class jokingly, I said, I'm losing my ox. And he has been that. He's been like a strong ox. You need something done, you can count on him to do it. Even last night, Nicole was at a friend's house, and she still doesn't have her license quite yet. And Heather and I were not about to go get her at night. So we said, go get your sister from her friend's house. And he went and did that. Now, when we come back, I think she's going to get her license. We think. We hope. We pray. But we're going to miss Trent. And I think it was Hannah Galaski that said, it's kind of like an end of an era. And I said, thanks. You've really made me feel great about that. An end of an era. And the Galaskis are gone this weekend. But the Cushels leaving this summer. And then Trent decided he's going to leave right on the heels of the Cushels. And so that is big time stuff for me. And so if I seem a little different, if I seem like I'm trying to get myself together, if I seem like a sad sap, it's because I am. I'm surprised I'm not even crying right now, but I'm going to save it all for when we say goodbye to him on campus. We're going to let him be there just long enough to make some friends, and then we're going to kiss and slobber all over him and say goodbye. He wants us just to drop him off and leave, but we're not going to let him get away that easy. And I know he wants that, but we love him too much to just do that. Now, maybe by the time Johnny goes, that's what we'll do. That's how it was in our family. Maddie just got sent. Maddie got a stiff kick in the pants, and my brother Ben took him down to college. That's basically how that went. He still jokes about that today. But was you going to say something about that, Mimi? Okay. That's true. He was out of the country. Yes. Yes. Oh, okay. Sorry. Well, anyway, I wasn't the one given the stiff kick in the pants, and neither was Maddie. I was the one who got ushered down, and they stayed with me for a couple of days, and then they hugged, and I'll never forget them leaving to go by in their vehicle, and I turned around and walked into Yun Tower. And I thought I was pretty good stuff. And then After that first night and the next day, I thought to myself, man, I miss home. And so you think you're big, bad stuff until you're there. And then you realize, man, this is real. And I'm really trying to make it on my own now. And but anyway, I say all that just to say, humor me, sorry, thank you for listening to me. I should have never said all that. But we love and miss Trent. And be sure to spend some time saying goodbye to him. That's really what it is. It's just saying goodbye and pray for him. Yeah, he needs that, doesn't he? Well, let's do that. Let's close in a word of prayer. And I'll go ahead and pray for us all tonight. And then we'll go downstairs and we'll get in a food line and enjoy some time of fellowship together. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time together this evening. And we do commit our college students to you. I think of several that we mentioned tonight. Trent's here tonight. And we do want to be sure that we bid him farewell and let him know how important he's been to us. Lord, to me personally, he has meant so much. And I've been able to count on him for anything I've asked him to do. And I can think of the years upon years of knocking on doors, the years upon years of getting to church on Sunday mornings before anyone else did, and setting everything up and putting out hymnals and setting up and breaking down chairs. Lord, there's been no part of the history of Truth Baptist Church that Trent has not been intimately and intricately involved in. And so for that, we are thankful for him. But we're also thankful for the young man that he is and the future that's in front of him. We do pray for him, and we do lift him before you tonight. May the church family who's here tonight let him and others know that they're loved and we miss them. And we're praying for all of them as they are transitioning into adulthood and taking this next important step. I pray that you would keep Trent protected at college as well as the others. Lord, keep evil influences away. I pray that good influences and good friends would be a part of his everyday existence. And even his roommates, Lord, and others, I just pray that he would have good, strong influences. May you have him meet the right people and be able to avoid the wrong people. I ask that he'd be able to manage all the details of day-to-day living, but also classes and achieving grades and finishing projects and writing papers. There's a lot involved with all of that. But Lord, we know that with your help, nothing's impossible for you. So help him with all those things. Help him to know that he's loved by his family as well as his church family. Be with us tonight in the food and the fellowship and the time together. Thank you for the gift of children, for seeing them transition into the next step and phase of life. That is a blessing. It's hard to say goodbye, but it's also a blessing to watch them take the step that you want them to take for the next important part of their life. Thank you for your love for us. Give us a great rest of this night. Bless the food to our bodies and the fellowship together. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you.